post a small goal and with the expectation that you'll go over and just hope that that's enough money. We definitely had a much smaller scope for the game in mind. We were thinking maybe each chef will have three attacks and it'll be more, something more like Towerfall, where you're like, you got a bow and like maybe a melee attack, and then we'll add like one more spell for each character, you know? And then we thought, oh, it'll be like a tournament structure, more like a fighting game than a story campaign. So no matter what character you choose, you'll do the same like three things. You'll like shop in town, you'll challenge a chef, and you'll make your way through this tournament bracket. And that seemed really nice and simple. And that's why we promised three playable chefs right on the Kickstarter. And then we hit Ziggy for a fourth one as a stretch goal. We really should have thought that out more, but I think it all worked out. And luckily, I make sure to post an update, a backer update every month. And so far, no one has been angry at us. We've had the huge luck that all of our backers have been really nice. And I'm not really sure why that is. I think part of it is because we don't have a huge number. There are 3,000, but it's not 20,000 where people were backing it without really understanding what the game was. I think people were also really attracted to the art. And obviously we still have the art that hasn't gone away. And I think we ended up expanding the game in ways that were better for the game instead of expanding it in sort of a match the goals sort of way. And I think the basic way is that we ended up with more quality over quantity, especially in terms of the chefs. We ended up with like a huge number of monsters and three different biomes. And we expanded the story and the voiceover and the role of all the characters dramatically. And so Mina and Thrash have a really... They each have sort of intertwined, but they each have their own story. And that sort of grew naturally out of the project, because as we realized that the hunting really needed to be a better system, we added more combos, more moves, made it closer to Super Smash Brothers. It's still like 10 to 12 different moves that combo well, instead of Super Smash Brothers, where it was like 50. But we took some of those lessons to make sure that hunting was fun by itself, and then making sure that cooking was fun by itself. And at that point, you've invested so much in making a character, especially with our art style where it's all hand-drawn and hand-animated, that if we just said, oh, all the chefs are boring and they're hot swappable and you could play as any chef and it doesn't mean anything, it just felt so wrong to invest so much art-wise and then into these characters, and that we just wanted to tell stories with them. And so that's just sort of was the direction we couldn't help but go. So now there's nearly entirely voiced stories that you're playing through with all these characters. We ended up with about 50 characters with voices done by 13 actors. And so they're like very significant stories. And that was so much better for the game than having a few sort of token playable characters instead of a couple really well fleshed out characters.
Now with the actors, did you find those locally in the Chicago area, or was it more of a everywhere search where people were like sending in voice samples digitally?
There's a huge mix. Starting the instant the Kickstarter was doing well, we started getting emails, and a whole bunch of the voice actors are also backers. And so, but we also just collected, I think basically due to the Kickstarter, collected the emails of many more voice actors over time. And then we, our audio guy, George Huffnagel, also knew a whole bunch of voice actors. So we sort of mixed some of those together. And then Eric went through and picked whose voices might work out. And so it ended up being a mix. And that was sort of a scary moment as a result, was when we realized that about half of our actors were union in SAG-AFTRA and half weren't.
Ooh, yeah.
and that's a big no-no under the normal SAG-AFTRA video game contract, the interactive contract. But luckily they have a lower budget sort of indie contract. And we were able to get a waiver and all that. And so it was resolved, but there was a moment where we were like, uh-oh, do we choose the union actors or the non-union? But it turned out that SAG-AFTRA was really understanding, and they, not too long ago, added a new contract to handle this sort of situation where we're obviously not a AAA game, and they seem really understanding that we wanted to get some of our Kickstarter backers into the game and hire them on as well as the more fancy union folks.
That all sounds like a huge adventure, though, where you are making a video game and then you're also kind of making a cartoon at the same time.
Yeah, and that's sort of that fits with what Battle Chef Brigade is, you know. it's sort of this like graphic novel where you happen to also have a like complex brawler in it, and then like Tetris Bejeweled. It just ended up sort of being this giant thing that felt really right. Like, it was so hard for us to imagine removing any of these ingredients, essentially.
Nice. Nice.
And so we just had to do it.
I just, a quick question for you personally. I mean, we have this rich cast of characters. Is there anyone that you identify with personally?
Well, that's a good question. It's really hard not to identify with Mina, even though Eric wrote a lot of himself into Mina, especially initially, and then she sort of evolved with the game. Ziggy is probably the character I would maybe not identify with, but most want to be. He's sort of he's got a very complicated okay. backstory, let's say. But he serves sort of, he's got some time traveling stuff in his story. So he's really from sort of the modern era, and his cuisine is sort of American fast food. But he's got this sort of aloof personality that I really enjoy. And so I don't know if I really identify, but I wouldn't mind being the sort of Ziggy character. He ends up being critical to the story, but also happy and cheerful. And he makes quite a few hilarious jokes, thanks to our writers, from the modern day that the rest of the characters don't get, like mentioning food trucks. And he also mentions, I don't know how to make this sound funny, but the sort of internet error or HTTP error when you get a 404. So he does all sorts of things that don't fit into this world, and that makes it so charming and enjoyable.
That's awesome. I was into the fact that he listed cheeseburgers as his favorite food. So the fact that he's even like his fast food is his style of cuisine, I'm excited to find out more about that.
Excellent.
At a certain point, I was kind of surprised initially to see that Adult Swim Games is the publisher here, because I'm familiar with some of Adult Swim Games' other stuff, but that was normally like smaller, more bite-sized entries, like the rocket-powered unicorn, surgeon simulator stuff like that. So how did you catch on with them? How did they enter the equation?
So there's a very long story. Back when we were doing mobile games, some of our friends who had also left Wideload to form Ragtag Studios, they're working on Raise the Dead. They had all sorts of press attention. They were in the like Sony E3 Indies presentation long, long ago. And so they started down the publisher path. And they mentioned that they'd been talking to Steve over at Adult Swim Games. And I said, after we'd released Color Sheep and Orion's Forge, our mobile games, I reached out to Steve at Adult Swim and said, hey, Eric and I worked on this little platformer thing as sort of a prototype idea for a while. Are you interested at all? And he took it to team, and he was like, well, it's like another indie platformer. It doesn't matter how many interesting hooks you have. They're not really the thing that we're looking for. So I had reached out in that capacity a long time ago. And then as we got Battle Chef Brigade to the point where the Kickstarter was successful, and then we started going to conventions, especially with the Indie Mega Booth. And I think we started first in the PAX 10 at PAX West, and I do not remember the year. That was probably three PAX West ago, something like that. In any case, the Adult Swim booth was right across from that. And so we got it. We slowly started talking with them at each PAX or GDC that we would be at. They're always at those things. And eventually, our initial feeling of we don't need a publisher slowly turned into, wow, marketing is sort of hard. It would be really great if our three-person team had some publisher might behind marketing. So sort of in parallel with everything, I would reach out to publishers and try to get their general feelings about the game and what a marketing deal with them would look like. And then it was about 2 years ago, year and a half, we were at PAX East, and all the indie advice from the luminaries was that you shouldn't do a publisher marketing only contract. You should get some money so they have skin in the game, like get an advance on essentially royalties. And then things got a little real with each of the publishers I was talking with. And we were basically talking to a larger publisher who had a history in these sorts of games, but it was more of a corporate thing. And when the subject of money came up, it turned into like, oh, we got to have green light meetings. And that was not what we wanted to hear after escaping Disney. We were also talking to a really small publisher, and I really liked the people, but they didn't have the money to do some sort of an advance. And Adult Swim was ready to go on all fronts, basically. As you mentioned, they were at the time best known for mobile things, fairly small mobile games, but those had been very successful and they had been growing significantly since then. And so when we'd see them at PAX, each time we'd see their booth getting larger and not only larger, but more well thought out. And that was really impressive to us because it is a huge pain to be lugging around monitors and computers and swag, all the like a couple hundred pounds of stuff to set up a little booth. And we were like, oh, if we sign with a publisher, then they do all of this. This is a really good idea. And then when you apply that thinking to a lot of the other things that a publisher offers, like QA and making trailers and all sorts of marketing platform relationships, it starts looking like, oh, maybe I could do those things myself, but it would be a lot better if someone else did. And some of our friends in the indie community here in Chicago have demonstrated that you can do it yourself. The Young Horses are a really good example. They made Octodad, and we go to indie lunch with them all the time. And I'm like, okay, if their team can do it, then I can do it. But then at some point you realize that in some ways the environment, especially Steam, has changed now that Greenlight was added, and now just Steam Direct, and the number of games on Steam has exploded since Octodad came out. And then you also got to realize that they had a team of sort of 7+ people, and so you can delegate a large amount of these marketing tasks to one person. And I realized that I was not going to be able to do that just by myself. So we also looked for people like just a marketing team, because there are sort of like indie marketing people and teams that you can use. But at some point we realized that we'd bitten off way more than we could chew and needed more money, not just because it was a good idea to encourage the publisher to have skin in the game, but also because we were going to run out and either have to really cut back on what Battle Chef Brigade could be, or find someone who was willing to turn it into what it really should be.
Now you mentioned Octodad and earlier Ragtag Games, and they were at that point, it seems like PlayStation was where all the indie games were going to roost. Like prior to that, the Xbox had been with the Summer of Arcade stuff, and now it seems like Nintendo is taking that stance. They've got their nindies, and Battle Chef Brigade happens to be one of the nindies and as part of that lineup. And I was just wondering, it seems to be generating a lot of good buzz for you guys. Have you had the opportunity to take a look at that and just your game on the most sought after Nintendo console that's on the market right now?
Yes, we live in fear though.
Oh,
Because
no.
I think everything I've been saying to the team and other indies recently that everything is going right, and that's good, but it's still very scary because for so long it's sort of like this indie wisdom that you should never release a small to medium large game during the holidays because that's when all the big games come out. And so when the opportunity presented itself, basically due to Nintendo saying that no, a holiday release would be a good idea potentially, a lot of the sort of Nintendo press was sort of contingent on like, hey, are you going to be releasing anytime soon? And we said maybe we are. And then upon thinking about it a lot and a lot of discussions with Adult Swim, we decided that, as you said, it is potentially the right time to release a medium game on Switch during the holidays, because a lot of the really big games aren't being released on Switch yet. it could work out really well. It seems like the holidays will amplify whatever's going to happen with a game. It's just scary to put even more of our cards on the table, but it seems like everything is lining up well. It seems like this Switch, as you're saying, is the sought after console and